Good morning. Welcome this morning to worship here at Walnut Grove. We're glad that each one of you were able to make it out this morning as we go through. Special thank you this morning to Betty Osberger for bringing the message this morning. So thank you in advance. A few announcements this morning. We are still doing the weekly prayer gatherings at 9 o'clock Monday mornings here at the church. Don't forget, while Doug's gone, Pastor Jonathan Hanover is the one that you need to get a hold of in case of some sort of a pastoral emergency or something like that. And his number is in the bulletin as we go through there. We are having an ad council meeting on June the 6th at 6:30. Mission Society is going to meet on Tuesday, June the 7th at 11:30 at Mr. Cheesy's Inn in Dunkirk. Any other announcements? Todd?
So the audits on all the treasurer's books are done. So any treasurers for any of the organizations that turned in their books, I put them back in the office. So if there's anything you guys want to pick up, pick them up. But they're all done and everything came out great, and we'll get those sent into the conference.
Okay, thank you, Todd. Appreciate it. Once again, he said that the audit is done, and if you are a treasurer, I've been waiting on my books. So if you're a treasurer, the books are back here in the office where they put them. Everything turned out good. Any other announcements at this time? If not, let's enter into a time of worship with our morning prayer. Thank you, Lori. Now at this time, I'm going to ask that if you are able, please stand with me for the call to worship, and then we'll follow that with a song of adoration. We gather here as the people of God. We gather here as a people of love and hope.
To the
world of grace and Christ. Let it be so. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 30, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, verses 1, 2, and 4. And if you're able, please stand and sing with me. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be here to worship together as a church family, and we'd ask that you be with us now as we lead into this worship service. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated, please. Our first scripture lesson this morning comes from the book of Jeremiah, and it's actually just verses 23 and 24. There's a misprint in the bulletin, so we'll go with that. This is what the Lord says. Let not the wise boast of their wisdom, or the strong boast of their strength, or the rich boast of their riches. But let the one who boasts boast about this, that they have the understanding to know me, that I am the Lord, who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For in these I delight, declares the Lord. This is the end of the reading. Thanks be to God. Okay, so at this time we're going to move into a section of prayer, followed by the Lord's Prayer. Are there any prayer concerns or joys or praises that anyone has? Hannah's going to bring the mic around.
On the news this morning, I don't know if you heard that in Coshocton, the Grace United Methodist Church had a fire on Friday, severe fire, and it burnt It looks like a total loss. And on the news this morning, it said that as the firefighters were recovering what could be salvaged in the building, there was a picture of Jesus that was saved. And I thought, praise God. He's letting us know he's there.
I'd like prayers for Dick Jones, who was in the hospital last week. He's home now, but he's had quite a time.
Mason Bloom.
You're awful quiet. Bob McBride is never quiet, so Bob, come on.
Thank you, Hannah.
Oh, I think, no, we want to continue to pray for the United Methodist Church going forward and the decisions that have to be made. It's a big deal. So just keep that in our prayers.
Let us take a few moments here in silence as Lori plays for us to pray for those things that are on our own hearts. I know that there are prayer requests out there that didn't get made, but go ahead and make those to the Lord right now as Lori plays a little bit for us before I pray. Lori. Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come to you today with many things on our hearts and minds, and we lift those things that we've just said up to you. We know that you'll handle them the way that you need to take care of them. We thank you, dear Lord, for the past week. It's nice to see some of the little corn coming up through the ground and maybe some soybeans coming up through the ground. The miracle of growth that we see throughout the countryside. Even in this, in the path of some of the storms that went through, we still thank you for all of those things that we do. A lot of things to be thankful for, dear Lord, but then there are also a lot of things that we need to pray for, and we want to make sure that we pray for those different types of things. For the United Methodist Church in Coshocton, we just pray for their congregation that somehow that they find a way to continue worshiping you, even with the loss of their building as they go through, remembering that the church is not just a building. It's a community of family and friends that come together to worship you. We pray for Dick Jones, who'd been in a hospital and glad that he's out, but he has some recovery to do. We pray for Mason, as he needs our prayers definitely. And we do pray for those people that are on our prayer list: Dick, Lori, Jerry, Linda, Steve, Bob, Mason, Kathy, Kim, Bob, Louie, and we pray for our church, the Methodist Church, our church in particular here at Walnut Grove. And we pray for our pastor, Doug, and we pray that he is enjoying his time, that he's away, and we pray that he is regaining some of his youth and vigor. So when he comes back, he'll be all raring to go with us as we go through there. We pray for our country and we pray for our world. Seems like we're in really, really tough times right now, but we know that you're there to guide us through and help us with all the things that are going on. All of these things we pray, we pray in your son's name, your son who taught us to pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, so it looks to me like we're going to sing another hymn of praise. I think we can do this one just sitting down. I won't ask you to stand. Wonderful Words of Life. It's number 692 in the hymnal, and it's also up on the screen. I couldn't hear you last time, so I'm going to let you sit down, but that means you're going to have to project a little more. So let me hear you as we sing, Lori.
Good morning. Good morning. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I am Betty Augsburger, glad to be here, an old friend. I've come and gone with worship and just see you in Kenton at the fairgrounds and whereabouts, but I am glad to be here to share and worship with you. And I'm going to read from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, and we're going to start at 24. This is a little high. I mean, it's not bad high. I'm just short. So, but anyway, this works for me. So this is good. So let us hear the word of the Lord. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it exactly as the women had said. But Jesus they did not see. And so then Jesus says to them, "O foolish men and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and to enter into his glory?" Then beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself in all the scriptures. Amen. And I think you see a picture up here. I think we're all kind of familiar with this picture. It is the Walk to Emmaus picture. If you've ever attended the retreat weekends, this is the picture that you see about everywhere. And I have found this last week. There are other pictures, but I like this picture. The other thing about it is that if you look closely, the disciple to, it would be your left, doesn't have a face on it. And the artist, this is what I've read, when he did the painting, he wanted to put himself in the picture. And so he didn't put the face on it. Another part is that they say the artist was wanting you, the person looking at the picture, to put yourself in it. So that would be another reason why he didn't put a face on it. And we also remember this picture or this scripture that I read as a resurrection scripture. Why would I be speaking about this today? We're past that. You know, this isn't an Easter thing. I personally love this picture. I first came to know this picture when Todd and I were married as a wedding gift. We were given this picture. It was on like a decoupage on a thing there. There again, that dates me way back in the day that we had that. And yes, I was a new Christian, but I wasn't familiar with the story that went along with it. So that was one of my first stories Todd told me about, was the Walk to Emmaus. And of course, over the years, I've heard it. But this picture has grown very dear to me, and we'll go into that. And right off, it's just because if you're looking at this, it's two people and Jesus. But the funny thing about this in the story, which we'll go into, is that these two guys did not know this was Jesus. The two of them are just walking along. They have seen their Savior die and buried, and they were going back home. These disciples, they knew Jesus, and they learned from him, and they loved him. And now all their hopes, all their dreams, beyond a best friend, is gone. So they're talking, there's grief, there's walking and talking in dismay, and there's silence, I'm sure, questions, probably some grumbling. And now a stranger catches up with them. Here comes this next person. And he's listening to their conversation. We know, there again, the stranger is Jesus, but these disciples were prevented from recognizing him. But Jesus knows them. And he's listening to them. And then Jesus says, well, what are you throwing back and forth between yourselves as you're walking along? Well, duh, what planet have you been living on? Don't you know what's been happening? And all their emotion, all their grief, all their anger, frustration spills out upon the road. It's about Jesus, a man. Our man, our Messiah, mighty in work, in word. He was taken. There were soldiers and temple priests. Trial, a sentencing. He was mocked and he was beaten. And he, believe it or not, was crucified. Crucified like a common criminal. Dead. And he was laid in a borrowed tomb. Now he's buried and he's gone. But then these women came around and said they had gone to the tomb and they found it empty and there wasn't a body there. They said they saw two men and these men were saying that, well, Jesus is alive. Well, you know women. But Peter and John took off for the tomb again. And they too said there's no body. Jesus isn't there. The tomb is empty. But then Mary said, and Peter, well, you know, Peter is the disciple who, we don't like to say it, but he denied even knowing Jesus that awful night. Well, they both said that Jesus, yes, is alive, that he appeared to them. And how can anyone believe Such a thing, such a tale, such a story, dead as dead. And now, the Word who became flesh, now truth speaks. You foolish ones, dull of perception, sluggish in mind, slow of heart, to trust and to learn everything the prophets have spoken, wasn't all of this necessary? And there again, beginning with Moses and with the prophets, Jesus reasoned with them concerning and referring to himself. Truth explaining, truth interpreting. Here is truth. Now these three walking on the road have become one. One in spirit, one in word, one in conversation, one in reason, one in him. As they walked, and then the two, they still are unaware of Jesus' presence with them. Then they arrive to their destination, and the disciples are turning in, and the stranger is moving on. But they invite him, please stay with us. Are you hungry? Will you offer the blessing? So the bread is offered to Jesus. The bread is broken. The bread is received, and their eyes are opened. It is Jesus. There's recognition, clear recognition without question. The present stranger is now the seen Savior. He is risen and alive, the Messiah, the promised one, and who now has vanished from their midst. But now he was never more clearly visible. Were not our hearts burning as he explained the scriptures? Has your heart ever burned from reading the scriptures? Have you ever, you know, there's a scripture that you've read time and time again, and all of a sudden you read it another time when you just really needed it and your heart is warmed. John Wesley speaks of his heart being strangely warmed. The author Bob Benson states, when we admit we do not have any bread, we admit to our own hunger, then we suddenly know and recognize who Jesus is, heavenly manna restored and given again. In life, we don't need reasons or answers. We need a someone. Jesus doesn't give us a plan. He gives us himself. Warmth for the cold, peace for the troubled, fellowship for the alone, courage for the afraid, strength for the weak, and songs for the sad, and bread for the hungry. Then that very hour, the same two disciples hit the road again. And this time they're running. They're not walking. They're running back to Jerusalem, finding the others, stumbling over each other to tell. We were on the road. This stranger seemed to know nothing, but knew everything. And our hearts burned. And he stayed with us and broke the bread. And our eyes were opened. It was Jesus. He is alive. And Jesus says, here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door and invites me in, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. They say the most intimate act between one another is in sharing of a meal together. Isn't there any more comfort in any of us as when we gather together with others in the breaking of bread? And that is just what Jesus did. If you look over our gospel readings, every day he ate with his disciples, the final special Lord's Supper, the end of this road, on a beachfront in Tiberias, the resurrected Jesus eats with his loved ones again and throughout history, and now with us today and every day. And Jesus does come, perhaps as a stranger at first, listening and listening. Isn't that quite a thought that Jesus, we think that he's not around, but he could very well be listening to us, and he is listening to us. And he asks us, what are you tossing back and forth in your mind, in your life? Dull of perception, slow of heart, sluggish in mind? And then from the prophet Isaiah, this is what the Lord says, let the wise truly know me and understand that I am the Lord. Have you ever had a week where everything you try to attempt or do, you just got to do it again? You've done it and somehow it all falls apart, or this went that way, well, it should have went that way, so you just begin again and you begin again, or this plan that you had all this potential and it just blows up, it just didn't come out that way, you gotta what? Do it again. Well, that's been my week. I'm not just because I'm speaking here, it has nothing to do with it, just how it was, and we all have them. And I came to this conclusion about myself. I didn't do very well in geometry in school. I don't know about you, it just never clicked for me. And I decided, I know why that is because you all remember the formula, the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. I don't know what a straight line is. That doesn't happen for me. It just doesn't. Do I get the job done? Oh, yeah, eventually it happens, but not like what some other people do. I gotta go this way and that way. It just, not in my world. And then there's the church phrase we use, moving on to perfection. We've all heard that. Judge Barrett and I have had numerous conversations about moving on to perfection, and I don't even know what perfection looks like. It just doesn't happen. I mean, yes, it's fine, but it's certainly, I don't think, what we perceive to be perfection. I live by grace and more grace alone, and perhaps that is perfection. I don't know. But the author Elizabeth Elliot writes, the trail or road is steep and very rocky, and it gets steeper and rockier the nearer we get to the summit. The company of a friend does not make the distance shorter, but it makes it seem shorter. It doesn't eliminate any of the rocks, but the rocks don't seem so daunting. The glad receiving of the yoke, the bread of Christ, cuts in half our life's burden. The road is still a tough one, but the roughness won't matter nearly as much. It is said that pain has a voice, but it doesn't have the final say. And I love that. Pain has a voice, but it doesn't have the final say. Jesus has the final say. Jesus is that final say. And I've heard it said, you really don't know the living Savior and his strength and that loving presence until he makes himself known in that deafening silence, the breaking of heart and spirit. Jesus does come. He comes alongside of us on our roads, in the kitchen, in the bedrooms, in the shower, mowing the lawn, and yes, even in our Hardin County courthouse. That's where I work. So I'm just telling you, he even shows up there, hallelujah, in our church pew. He waits and he listens. He speaks, but he also waits for the invitation from you. A friend was encouraging another friend by asking, what do you have to lose by trusting God, even when it doesn't make any sense? And they said, well, nothing. I have nothing to lose, I guess, by trusting God. And perhaps I have everything to gain. Perhaps we have everything to gain. Scripture says, he who seeks to save his life will lose it, yet he who will lose his life for my sake, for Jesus, will find it, will gain it. So that's just kind of different for us to think about it. When we lose, we do gain. I was reminded not so long ago that when Jesus approached Calvary, and I love the cross up here, but when he approached that and the road that he suffered, I think of him as dying as he's going along. And I was reminded that Jesus was never more alive as he was going down that road, as he was placed on the cross, as he was up there. He was never more alive. For the joy set before him, he endured. And he says, for this reason I was born, and for this reason I came to testify to the truth, a truth that explains. I said at the beginning that this is one of my favorite Bible pictures. Again, it is Jesus talking with his people, questioning and reasoning and explaining, loving one who was with us. I've had to make some decisions the last couple of years in regards to faith and church, and I can't make any explanations for it, but simply put, I had to get back to this. We just assume that we have this. Well, we don't. Sometimes we walk away, not intentionally, but sometimes we just don't spend that one-on-one time, take that moment to say, Jesus. And it's personal. I can't do it for you, and you can't do it for me. It's one-on-one. Who do you say that Jesus is? Sometimes even good stuff in the church can distract us. We can think more of our serving and our ministries instead of him himself. I'm learning, always learning. Always, no matter how long you've been studying the scriptures, the word continues to speak every time you open it. Again, it's not about me and it's not about you. It's not about any of us at all. It is first and foremost and to the last all about Jesus. These two disciples had nothing. They just had themselves going back home. And Jesus walks in, just as he did with the blind, the lame, the dead, and even more. He walks up into our situations, onto our roads, and he enters our blindness, into our ignorance, and he gives himself. Wasn't all of this necessary? Here again, this challenge. Seek him while he may be found and call upon him while he is near. We are not alone. We have everything to gain in our coming together, in the breaking of the bread, in that still small voice. Who has that final say? Can we say it together? Who has the final say? Jesus. Jesus has that final say. And then their eyes were opened. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we love you and we praise you and just ask for your forgiveness for, again, doubting and getting lost in the dramas of our lives and the worries and frets and the unknowns that are heavy upon us. There's no doubt in that. But you are so with us to ease us, to give us rest, to come alongside and refresh, restore courage, reassure again. We thank you and honor you and love you, Lord, and thank you for the opportunity that we can come to again. But open our eyes, Lord, all the time. Open our eyes and our hearts and our minds. We make even faith so complicated, and it isn't. You have us covered, and you have that final say. And we too continue to lift up those that are on very difficult roads. And we do ask for courage and wisdom all the time. We do love you, Lord Jesus. And it's in your most holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Betty. Hopefully our eyes will open at the name of Jesus, and that he is the way that leads us to our path of eternity. Thank you again. The works of God are amazing, but by God's mercy, we are alive. In God's presence, we are filled with hope. One way to pass on the gift is to share our material wealth, which God entrusts us to, as we offer our substance to be blessed in service of the risen Christ. Let us rededicate ourselves as well. Let us pray. O God, by whose example giving is a blessed way of life, fill us now with the exultant joy of your love, which is more precious than gold. May we be bold to proclaim the gospel of salvation with glad hearts and with deep and genuine trust. Grant us the opportunity through these gifts and in our daily living to lead others in a life affirming faith in Christ's name. Amen. Our closing hymn is the Song of Life, Higher Ground. It's number 467 in the hymnal. We'll be singing verses 1, 3, and 4. I'm going to ask that everyone stand with me. Once again, everybody make sure we're singing out. And then I'm going to ask Betty to lead us in the benediction following the hymn.
It's a good day. This is the Lord's day, but it is a good day. And we'll have another good day tomorrow, regardless of the roads, because we're not alone. We're not alone. Yes, we have one another. We have family, but we know Jesus and love him and want to share him with others. Let them know he is alive, alive. And loves everyone and wants everyone to know that he is alive and he is a God who is with us. And now may the love of God and the love of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of the Holy Spirit who is with us and guides us and comforts us, may he be with us all. Amen.
First time I've heard.
Yeah, you do it. I forgot. For the note.